Christmas is just a week away, right? And on Christmas Day, basically, you know what we do, or what we're supposed to do, is to celebrate the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. Unfortunately, Christmas has been turned into what it was never intended to be. Hopefully, we're getting back Merry Christmas in America instead of Happy Holidays. You see, in America, we have so many holidays that the one that is reserved for Jesus, we should just be content to make it about Jesus. Does somebody agree with me?
Yes.
Yeah. So that means from now on, when you see somebody at this time, don't say Happy Holiday. Just go ahead and say Merry Christmas. Hallelujah. There are many other holidays that are coming and that have come. Praise the Lord. I prefer Merry Christmas. Amen. And so, we have this season of the year to think a little bit more about Christmas, to think a little bit more about what it is that we're celebrating. When we talk about Christmas, there are many stories of Christmas I'm sure you've heard, and there are many angles that you can look at what Christmas is. But this morning, I want us to think about the kind of story we get from Matthew chapter 1 that has a lot more to do than genealogy. If you remember the passage we read for the Bible reading, we read 25 verses. And what do you remember? Most of them were talking about this one begat this, and even the names, we were stumbling on reading the names. And I'm sure somebody is saying, Pastor, what do we have to do with all these names, right? But this morning, we are going to pay attention to that portion of the scriptures because it says a lot to us more than just a bunch of names in the genealogy of Jesus. And so I titled the message this morning, The Redeemer Who Broke the Rules to Save Us. The Redeemer Who Broke the Rules or the Traditions Just to Save Humanity. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Now, Jesus did not come just as every other people, person that are called Savior came in other parts of the world. He came differently, and his story is unique. And for us to appreciate who Jesus is and what he did, you have to study what happened even way before the birth of Jesus. Now, turn with me to Matthew chapter 1. Verse 1, I read, the book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham begat Isaac, and Isaac begat Jacob, and Jacob begat Judah and his brothers. Judah begot Perez and Zerah by Tamar. Perez begot Hezron, and Hezron begot Ram. That's verse 3. Now, if you read all the way, you will see this goes on until verse 16. And verse 17 now says, so all the generations from Abraham to David are 14 generations. From David until the captivity in Babylon are 14 generations. And from the captivity in Babylon until Christ are 14 generations. I want to camp there. Now, Jesus came. His birth was announced by angels in so many places. Number one, it was an angel that appeared to Mary and told her that she's going to conceive and she's going to have a child, and that child will be by the Holy Ghost. It was an angel that appeared to Joseph, the mother of the earthly father of Jesus, that he was going to be a father of this child called Jesus. When you go to Luke chapter 2, it was an angel that appeared to shepherds while they were watching their sheep by night, and exclaimed to them about the birth of Jesus. If you go to Matthew chapter 2, the Bible says to us that there were, we call them magi, the wise men that came from the east. It was not an angel that appeared to them, it was a star. a very unique and strange star that led them from east all the way several hundreds or perhaps thousands of miles to the very house where Jesus was as a baby. And so you begin to look at this, you begin to see so many divine activities that were present about the birth of Jesus. In the Old Testament, we have about 300 prophecies that were written in the Old Testament concerning the life of Jesus, about his birth, his life, his death, and his resurrection. There are six of them, at least six, maybe more than six, that concern his birth specifically. And when you look at them, Jesus fulfilled every one of these six prophecies that were spoken about him about his birth. Now, there's no way somebody can determine where they're going to be born. There's no one that determines the circumstances under which they're going to be born. But guess what? When you look at the life of Jesus, everything that was said about where he's going to be born, how he's going to be born, the lineage where he's going to come from, everything was fulfilled. Number one, it was prophesied that Jesus was going to be from the line of Abraham. God told Abraham that in Genesis chapter 12. Guess what? Matthew chapter 1, when we read it, it tells us Abraham, the father, the forefather of Jesus. It was fulfilled. We are told that Jesus was going to be born in Bethlehem. All right? Bethlehem of Judah. And it was fulfilled exactly as God said that. Micah told us that, Micah chapter 2. We are told that Jesus was going to be born at the time of his birth. There will be sorrow that will accompany his birth. In Matthew chapter 2, what did Herod do? As soon as he heard that a child was born, what did he do? And he said, well, you wise men, go and find out where he is and bring news to me, right? But an angel of God said, don't go back to him. He got angry, and he massacred pretty much every child that was 2 years and under. And the Bible says there was wailing in the entire city of Jerusalem. It was already foretold that was going to happen. And so when you begin to look at the prophecies about Jesus, specifically about his birth, Jesus fulfilled all of them. When it came time for Jesus himself to come, angels were showing up everywhere, talking to people. Point is this. What was so much of a big deal about the birth of Jesus that so many prophecies talked about him? Abraham was told he will have a seed, and through his seed, the whole world will be blessed, right? David spoke about Jesus. Isaiah spoke about Jesus. Jeremiah spoke about Jesus. Micah spoke about Jesus. Zechariah spoke about Jesus. Daniel spoke about Jesus. What is so big about the birth of Jesus? What is so big about the birth of Jesus is found in that Matthew that we read, chapter 2. Now let's turn over there and look. Matthew chapter 2. Are you there? Yes. All right. Here we go, verse 21. This is the angel speaking to Joseph, and she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. She will bring forth a son. You will call his name Jesus, because he will save his people from what? Their sins. Listen up. The big deal about Jesus is found in his name. And Jesus is the Greek of the word Yeshua, Joshua, which means the Lord is salvation. So the meaning of Jesus, the name itself, is salvation. Salvation from what? From our sins. That is the big deal about the birth of Jesus. Now, it is possible to say, well, Pastor, really about from sin? How come it's not from Satan? How come it's not from all the troubles that we experience? How come it's not from all the headache and the pains we experience? You mean 300 prophecies talk about Jesus? You mean all these prophets are talking about Jesus? You mean angels came to announce the birth of Jesus just because Jesus is coming to save us from sin? Yes, You know why? Because sin is the cause, the foundation, the root cause of every problem that we have in humanity. The greatest enemy or the greatest danger Jesus could come to save us from is not Satan. It is sin. Listen to this. It was sin that caused the separation between God and man in the first place. The Bible says when Adam and Eve disobeyed God and they sinned in the Garden of Eden, what happened? Satan did not drive a wedge between man and God. Sin did. So God drove them out of the garden and he put a cherub at the door that they would never come back. It was sin that removed the glory of God on man. When they sinned, they started hiding. They realized that they were naked. God said, I created you with glory. How come you're hiding? Because they had sin. It was sin that now gave power to Satan over humanity. Every problem that you experience, every problem that I experience, the cause of it ultimately is sin. All the disappointments that we experience, all the pain we experience, people murdering other people, people, you know, being unjust to other people, is as a result of sin. And so for Jesus to come and to save us from every trouble that beguiles us, he has to first save us from sin. He shall call his name Jesus, Yeshua, because he will save his people from their sins. Praise the Lord. Now, Jesus did not only come to save us from our sins, he saved us from the consequences of our sins as well. It's one thing for Jesus to save us from our sins and leave all the problem that sin has brought into our life. But the Bible says the reason why there was so much said about Jesus, there was so much preparation about Jesus, there is so much celebration on earth and in heaven about the birth of Jesus is that he came to save humanity from sin and the consequence of our sins. And think about this. What brought death to the world? Sin. God said, the day you eat of that fruit, you shall die. What sends people to hell? Sin. Satan has no power to send any soul to hell. But sin is at the root cause of every pain and ache on earth or even in eternity. And so, if Jesus could save you and I from Satan, but he hasn't saved us from sin, we are not saved yet. If Jesus could save us from financial problems, but he hasn't saved us from sin, we still have a big problem because eventually that sin will take a soul to hell. And so what I want you to be tracking with this morning is that the most important thing about the birth of Jesus, what made his birth such a big deal is that he came to save us from the greatest problem we have, which is sin. Once Jesus saves a man from sin, he automatically saves him from Satan and from all the pain that come with sin. But you know what? Why did we look at the genealogy just a moment ago and why are we going there? This is where you can begin to see the redemption of Jesus in human life. How Jesus saves from sin and from the consequences of sin. Obviously, for Jesus to do that, he broke some rules. And that's really what I want to share with you this morning. The first rule that Jesus broke to be our Redeemer is the rule that I call the exclusion of women from genealogy. Now, traditionally, women were not included when the ancient writers would list the lineage of a person or the genealogy of a person or the family tree of a person. It would just be about the sons and sons and sons and sons. Now, let me ask you a question. Whoever came to the world without a woman? It's not possible. But guess what? They will just list all the men as if all the people that came to the world were not through women. Examples are in Genesis, it's in Exodus, it's in Israel, it's everywhere. Let me show you one example in the scripture. In the book of Genesis, we can look at it real quick. Genesis chapter 25, verse 12 to 16. Just one out of several. Genesis 25, 12 to 16. Now this is the genealogy of Ishmael, Abraham's son, whom Hagar the Egyptian, Sarah's maidservant, bore to Abraham. And these were the names of the sons of Ishmael by their names, according to their generations. The firstborn of Ishmael, Nebahot, then Kedah, Abdil, Mibzab, Mishma, Duma, Massa, Hadah, Tema, Jetod, Nephish, and Kedema. These were the sons of Ishmael, and these were their names by their towns and their settlements, 12 princes according to their nations. Does that mean Ishmael didn't give birth to any daughter? Yes, he did. But that is the tradition. Before Jesus' time, specifically the genealogy of Jesus, when you read the genealogies in the Bible, and even genealogies outside of the Bible, in those times, women were left out of the genealogies. But Jesus broke that tradition. Now, you will see the reason why we were reading the genealogy. Go back now to Matthew chapter 1. Four women were named in the genealogy of Jesus. I don't know if any one of us caught that. Tamar, Rahab, Ruth, and the wife of David, Bathsheba. So what happened is that even before Jesus was born, just listing his family tree, the redemption work, the redemptive activity of the life of Jesus was already taking effect many, many generations before Jesus. Because Jesus says, okay, you do not list women as if they are second class or as if they have no names, they have no faces. But in the genealogy of Jesus, Jesus, God, man, says, I'm going to list four women in my genealogy. You know what Jesus is doing? He was taking care of one of the effects of sin. I told you a moment ago that he came to redeem us from sin and the effect of sin. One of the effects of sin is that because sin came in through the woman, through Eve. The Bible tells us that very clearly. But sin passed to all humans through Adam, but it came in through Eve. Just in the mind of man generally, women had been placed on the bottom rung, you know, on the social ladder. Bottom rung is an understatement. It's as if, do you know that there are cultures today that still treat women just as properties? Well, it's much better now. It used to be a lot worse in every civilization, including the Jewish culture. So that when they listed, you know, if I'm a Jewish man and I have 10 boys and 8 daughters, if they were going to list my genealogies, they would just say the sons of, and they will mention 10, and 8 daughters, you will never see their name. But Jesus said, no. He is the Savior that forgave sin and began to reverse one of the problems of sin, which is the social status of women had been skewed. But Jesus began to reverse that. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. That is why Jesus is a spectacular and unique redeemer that broke the standing rules to show us redemption. Jesus came to redeem and restore women's social status by giving them place and name in his own genealogy. Jesus is one that lifts those that are marginalized. Jesus is the one that lifts up those that are categorized as unimportant. Jesus is the one that lifts up those that are classified as the underclass, the ones that need not to be mentioned. And I want you to know that if you still look at societies today all over the world, the societies and the cultures that have the highest place for women are the Christian societies. Just look at Islam. In those nations where Islam is the dominating religion, women are still treated very, very poorly. Jesus came and he was beginning to fix the problems that we have, one of them, the social problem of taking women out of where God intended them to be. Now, don't get me wrong. It is part of the original creation of God that women will be subject to their husband. The husband is the head. It's in the Old Testament, it's in the New Testament, so Jesus is not coming to change all of that. But the fact that women were so relegated to almost the properties of people, Jesus said, no, that's not right. Give them names and give them faces in my genealogy. Praise the Lord. I don't know any one of us, men or women, that may come from a place or a background or be in a social environment where, for whatever reason, maybe your gender or whatever else, you are one of the marginalized. You are one of those that you see yourself as not important, and even the culture tell you that you're not important. Jesus wants you to know how significant you are to God. That's why, as the divine creator, he said, put the names of all those women there, even though you guys don't do it, but I'm reversing it because I came to save man from sin and problems that came through sin. Praise the Lord. That's who our Jesus is. That's one of the rules he broke in his genealogy. Number two, the exclusion of Gentiles from the relationship with God. Jews were exclusively the chosen people of God in relationship with God before Jesus came. In other words, if you and I lived before the time Jesus came, there's no way you're going to be sitting here. You can't. I can't. We had no access to the worship of God like the Jews had. It wasn't racism or anything. It was what God himself said. God said, I have chosen the descendants of Abraham, the Hebrew, the Jews, all of them the same thing. I have chosen them to be the people that I have relationship with among the entire races in the world. That's the way God wanted it. That's the way he had it. But it was Jesus that brought us in. Let me show you some scriptures. Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 6 to 8. Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 6 to 8. Listen to what God was telling the people of God. For you are a holy people to the Lord your God. The Lord God has chosen you to be a people for himself, a special treasure above all the peoples on the face of the earth. The Lord did not set his love on you nor choose you because you are more in number than any other people, for you are the least of all people. But because the Lord loves you and because he will keep his oath he swore to your fathers, the Lord has brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the house of bondage, from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. God told the children of Israel, I have made you special above all the peoples of the earth. That is a fact. Now, another passage, Amos chapter 3, verse 2. Listen to what God said. You only have I known of all the families of the earth. It doesn't get more defined and exclusive than that. God said to the people of Israel, you alone I have known. I have come in relationship with among all the families, all the races and tribes of the earth. That means before Jesus, the people that were called the people of God were the Jews only. But Jesus turned that around. Now, watch what the Gentiles were called before Jesus. We were called strangers. We were called aliens as far as relationship with God is concerned. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 12. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 12 says that at that time, you, that includes me and you, except if a Jew is hearing me, the Bible says at that time, before Jesus came, you were without Christ, being aliens, that means foreigners, from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. That's the Gentiles. That's you and I before Jesus came. But Jesus changed that. You know, he didn't even change it just when he came. It was found in his genealogy. So, three of the four women mentioned, Tamar, Rahab, Ruth, and Bathsheba, three of them were Gentiles. So, when you read that genealogy now, you realize that it wasn't just there to fill space. God was showing us something. Jesus said, yes, I know I have chosen just the Hebrews for myself, but I am coming to redeem the whole world. I will break the rules so I can redeem all mankind. And so what he did, because he's God and man, he said, I will inject the Gentile blood into my line. Tamar was a Canaanite. Ruth was a Moabite. Rahab was a Canaanite. And all these were great-great-grandmothers of Jesus. You know what that means? Through these three women, God was giving Gentiles a place, a claim to Jesus. It wasn't by accident. It was by divine arrangement. That was the second rule Jesus broke. The exclusion of all of us Gentiles. Jesus said, I'm coming to redeem the whole world. So I'm going to put those women that are unbelievers, I'm going to put them in my line. They're going to become my great-great-grandmother. Jesus is the redeemer of all mankind. In Jesus, there is no exclusion. In Jesus, there is no one that is an outsider. In Jesus, there is no one that is unfit for salvation. In Jesus, there is no one that God cannot redeem or save. In Jesus, there is no one that is an outcast. He brought both the Gentiles that were once not a people of God and the Jews who have always been the people of God from Abraham. He brought them together and says, I am the redeemer of mankind. Just look at my history. You will know that I've meant it all along. Praise the Lord. That means there is no race on earth that God is not interested in saving through his son, Jesus Christ. So Jesus is not, salvation is not anymore exclusive to any race. I love what the scripture says in that Ephesians chapter 2, going further beyond verse 11. It basically says Jesus married the Gentiles and the Jews together and gave us salvation. Listen to it. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11 to 19. Therefore, remember that you once Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision made in the flesh by hands, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope and without God in this world. Verse 13, but now, that's the key, but now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Jesus. For he himself is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of separation, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, that is the law of commandments contained in ordinances, so as to create in himself one new man from the two, thus making peace, and that he might reconcile them both to God in one body through the cross, thereby putting to death the enmity. And he came and preached peace to you who were far off, that's me and you, to those who were near, for through him we both, means the Gentiles and the Jews, have access by one spirit to the Father. Now, therefore, you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. Praise the Lord. That's what Jesus did. And we found it even way back from his genealogy. There is no one the Lord is not interested in saving. No matter their background, no matter their social status, no matter where they come from. The third rule that Jesus broke is the rejection of the unworthy. Those that religiously they are not worthy, morally they are not worthy, even socially they are not worthy. They will be even people that you and I will say, well, I think even I can say those are not worthy. But guess what? That's what Jesus did. One of the ancient practices is that monarchs, like kings and political figures, when they wrote their biography and their conquest, they will leave out all the sour parts, all the parts that were not so good. They will leave it out. And so you just, you know, a king will write it by himself. I conquered 40 nations, and all of them, I beat them into smithereens. They will never remember or record the times they were beaten. That's just the practice. But you know what? Jesus didn't do that. In his genealogy, we saw that he recorded the good, like Abraham, and he recorded the bad, and even the ugly. And he says, all of them form my lineage. That's unique to Jesus. That's unique to Jesus. Now, listen to this. So he broke the rule of rejecting the unworthy and keeping them out as if they were not part of his family. He brought everybody and said, every one of these people, the good, the bad, and the ugly, they were my genealogy because I came to redeem all mankind. Two out of the four women in Jesus' genealogy were involved in prostitution. Tamar and Rahab. Those four women, two of them were involved in prostitution, and they were still the great-grandmother of Jesus. Two experienced miserable lives, Tamar and Ruth. One of them was involved in adultery and had her husband murdered, Bathsheba. But guess what? When Jesus was using Matthew to write the genealogy, he said, put all of their names there. They were my grandmother. Why? Because, yes, socially, they should be outcasts. So religiously, even spiritually, they have violated the laws of God. But I came to redeem even the outcast. Therefore, I made their story to be included in my story. Praise the Lord. I don't know if you know anything about Tamar, more than what I just said. But Tamar was the wife of the firstborn of Judah. Judah was the fourth son of Jacob. So when you're talking about Abraham, that's a good guy. Isaac, that's a good guy. Jacob, not so much. He was kind of a deceiver. But then when you get to his children, oh, they were a complete mess. Completely. It was them that says, well, this boy Joseph that has big mouth, why don't we just discard this guy? Those were the forefathers of the Israelites, okay? Murderers and all kinds of things. And Judah said, well, Reuben said, let's not kill him. I'll take him because he's the firstborn. He doesn't want to get in trouble. But Judah said, well, why, instead of us killing him, just take him out of the pit and sell him to these Ishmaelites. This same Judah. He was the one that said, let's sell him. Well, maybe he earns a point because he said, don't kill him, but sell him. But when Judah left the rest of his people, the Bible tells us in Genesis chapter 38, he found a Canaanite woman and married her. And the first son Judah had was named Er. He had three sons. One was Er, or E-R, you know, Er. Another one is Anon. This firstborn son got married to a woman named Tamar. But tragedy happened. The Bible says Er was a wicked man before God. Let's look at the story. I'm talking about the forefathers of Jesus. You'll be amazed that this is where Jesus came from. That's where he came from. And why did he come there? Because he came to redeem the worst of all. So he can give us hope. Are you there? Genesis chapter 38. Praise God. Verse 6. Then Judah took a wife for Er, his firstborn. And her name was Tamar. But Judah's firstborn was wicked in the sight of God. And what happened? And the Lord killed him. Just like that. Now, can you imagine you getting married to a fine man that supposedly came from a very good house? In fact, from a Christian home. All right? He's not reckless like everybody else. And after you got married to him, you realize that this man is a wicked man. And you say, well, but what happened? I married you from a quote-unquote good home. And bam, he just dies out of the blue without any child. And the minister says, ma'am, I'm sorry for your loss, but I just want to announce to you it was God that killed your husband. How would you feel? That's what happened. He wasn't sick. God killed him. So you would say, Tamar, you are unfortunate, but her woes continue. And Judah said to Onan, that's the second born. This is their practice in those days. Go in to your brother's wife and marry her and raise up an heir to your brother. That might be surprising to some people, but it's still practiced in some culture today. The firstborn is dead. He had no seed. The second born will go ahead and marry that wife so he can raise a seed for his brother. But Onan knew that the heir would not be his. And it came to pass when he went into his brother's wife, when in just means when he consummated, you know, the union with his brother's wife, that he emitted on the ground, lest he should give an heir to his brother. You understand what that means? The second son, Onan, when he had intimacy with the wife of the brother that was dead, when it was time to put his substance into the body of the woman, he threw everything on the ground because he said, if I do that, the child that will come is not going to be mine. So I don't want to raise a son for my brother. Look at, this is a messy family. And look what happened. And the thing which he did displeased the Lord. Therefore he, it's on the screen. Therefore what? Number two. These were the sons of Judah. So, when I say this woman was unfortunate, do you see what I mean? Two husbands have died. None of them gave her any child. But her trouble is going to continue. So, verse 11. Then Judah said to Tamar, his daughter-in-law, remain a widow in your father's house. The father-in-law tells Tamar, I know you are a widow now. Two of my sons have died. Remain a widow in your father's house till my son, Shelah, is grown. The third and the final one. And Tamar went and dwelt in her father's house. Do you know what this means? The man said, okay, well, the only thing I have left is I'll give you my last born son. But, I mean, the guy is a little boy, so you're going to wait. If Tamar waited, which she did, maybe by the time that guy grows up, the age gap will probably like 30, 40, maybe 50 years. You understand? That is how old she will be, how much she will be older than the next husband. You talk about an unfortunate woman. You will not even believe it except it's in the scripture, and we know it's true. So what did she do? Did she flee? She had options. She could have married and said, well, forget you. I don't know why all your sons are getting, you know, killed. They are wicked. That's why. I'm going to marry somebody else. But she didn't. Follow on with the story. He said that, lest he also die like the brother. So Judah now became deceptive. He said, well, instead of you staying in my house, go and stay in your father's house. When my child is grown, I will give it to him. But he meant not to do so. Can you blame him? Two sons have died with the woman. He said, I'm not going to give you the third one, but he didn't tell her that. He said, don't worry. When he's grown, I'll give it to you. But he didn't. Verse 12, now in the process of time, the daughter of Shua, Judah's wife, died. Judah lost his own wife. And Judah was comforted and went up to the sheep shearers at Timnah, he and his friend Hira and Adullamite. He was told Tamar, saying, look, your father-in-law is going up to Timnah to share his sheep. So she took off her widow's garment, covered herself with the veil and wrapped herself and sat in an open place which was on the way to Timnah, for she saw that Shelah was grown and she was not given to him as a wife. So she realized now that I'm being deceived. This man is not going to give me his third son. And so when Judah saw her, he thought she was a harlot. So what she did was, she took off mourning garment. She dressed like a harlot. She knew that Judah was going to fall for a harlot because he doesn't have a wife now. But is that a reason why he should sleep with a harlot? That tells you the morality level of Judah. The daughter-in-law knows that if he sees a harlot, he's going to want to sleep with a harlot. These are the grandparents of Jesus. And what happened? Did he fall for it or not? Yes. Verse 15. When Judah saw her, he thought she was a harlot because she had covered her face. Then he turned to her by the way and said, please let me come into you. So he did not know that she was his daughter-in-law. Because of time, if you read the rest of the story, so what Timnah did was, okay, you want to sleep with me? That's fine. I'm a harlot. Give me your ring, the cord, and your staff, so that I will know you're going to give me the little goat or little sheep that is going to be my prize. You will bring it. Before you bring it, just give those things. After a while, it was found out that Timnah was pregnant. They now reported to Judah, your daughter-in-law has played harlotry on you. She didn't wait for you to give her the third son. And Judah said, bring her out we're going to stone her to death. Can you imagine? The man that was himself deceiving says, we are going to stone her today because she played harlotry. She was not faithful to my family after two men. Timna now said, that's fine, just before you kill me, the one that this ring and this cord and this staff belong to, that's the baby father. And then when they realized that it was Judas, Judah now became sorry and said, oh, I messed up. But the point is, from that pregnancy, two babies came out. Twin, Perez and his brother. Perez is back in Matthew chapter 1, is one of the great grandfathers of Jesus. He came through adultery, harlotry, and incest. But he was still mentioned in the line of Jesus. If you were Jesus and you were writing your genealogy or your biography, would you put that there? Say, no, just leave that, you know, redact all of that out. That's what people do. But Jesus says, leave it right there. Because those are the kind of people I came to save. That's the third rule Jesus broke. The rejection of the unfit. Rahab. Who was Rahab? She's one of the women there. Anybody know the story of Rahab? She was a harlot, professional harlot. She left from Jericho to Israel because she believed. She said, well, I'm a harlot, but you know what? I know you guys are coming to destroy the whole place, so I put my faith in your God. Just rescue me when you are going. And just by that faith, she was saved, the only soul that was saved in whole of Jericho. And guess what? She later became the mother of Boaz. And who was Boaz? The one that married Ruth, the third girl mentioned there, who also was a Moabite, who also lost her son and had no child. You begin to see all these complications in the genealogy of Jesus. Now, fast forward to David, a great man of God. You say, that's one of them good ones that showed up. Until what happened? One day he was walking on the rooftop of his house and he sees a beautiful woman bathing, and he forgot that he was a man of God. And what did he do? He committed adultery. He said, well, I committed adultery, but now the woman is pregnant. What are we going to do? Let's go kill the husband. He killed Uriah, right? The husband. And he married Bathsheba, right? And the son that came out of that died. But God said, okay, you have repented. I see. I forgive you. I'm going to give you another son through the same woman. Named who? Solomon. Solomon was one of the grandfathers of Jesus. What is the point? The point is that not only did Jesus remove the social barrier for women, not only did Jesus remove the barrier for Gentiles to be saved, Jesus went to even the least likely people to be associated with the holy God and said, I want all of them, as messed up as they are, I want them to be part. Don't you think Jesus could have orchestrated everything that he will come through perfect line? Of course he's God. He said, no, I want all those unfit people to be part of my grandparents and grandfather, grandmother, so that when I come, I will be the savior of all humanity. He is the redeemer that broke all the rules to redeem us. If any one of us has experienced what these people experience, the story tells you already that Jesus says, I can save you. You are falling into adultery. I can save you because my great-grandfather David was an adulterer. But I still came through him. Somebody is into immorality. Jesus said, I can save you because I have plenty of them in my generation and I save them. Hallelujah. That's who Jesus is. He doesn't tell us to go live in sin, but he can save us from whatever sin and redeem us from whatever sin has brought upon our life. We will be hopeless if Jesus came only for the perfect. We will be hopeless if Jesus came for only for the perfect family. So I don't know, somebody is saying, well, my family is so messed up. All you got to do is read the story of the family of Jesus. You will see all kinds of messes there. But the Savior was still born there. The only woman that you can say was a good woman I don't know if you can say she's impeccable, but at least in her eyes, there is no problem we can say about her. He's Mary, the mother of Jesus. All the other women that were in his lineage, they were all messed up. So what is it in your life that Satan makes you feel inferior about? What is it in your life that Satan reminds you of every day? What is it in your life that you think because of that, I don't think God really loves me? It is a lie. But number two, who are those people that you look at and you think God can never save these people? Jesus says, who tells you that? Some of my grandmothers are worse than them. That's Jesus. Praise the Lord. And that is why we sang that song this morning. No other name but the name of Jesus. No other name but the name of the Lord. He's worthy of glory. He's worthy of honor. He's worthy of power and of praise. Because he came to break everything that was holding us bound. And he says, Jews, forget about being Jew. Gentiles, forget about being Gentile. All of you are making you sons of God through me. Adulterers, forget about being that. You know, harlots, forget about being that. Prostitutes, forget about being that. Come to me, I will forgive you, I will cleanse you, and I will make you a holy person. Mary Magdalene that served Jesus, Jesus drove out 7 demons out of her. If we had seen her today, we'd say, don't let her sit anywhere in the church. Oh. She's got 7 demons. Jesus says, put her in the front row. That's the one I'm going to change. Jesus met the woman at Jacob's well, right? Who has had how many husbands? 5. She's on the 6th one. That was not even her husband. And right there, Jesus turned out to an evangelist. Jesus said, I know you have 5 husbands already, but I'm going to show you who I am today. And from there, she left her water pot. She witnessed to the whole of Samaria and brought them to Jesus. That's what the Redeemer does. He meets you in your sin. He says, that's the problem. I put my blood to forgive you, and I'm going to cleanse you right now, and I'm going to make you a new person. That's Jesus, who breaks all the rules to redeem us. Let's rise up on our feet.